All right, I know the suspense has been killing you. Finally, in this video, we start to differentiate and explain the difference between our non-standard, our non-standard and standard delta G values. And we're going to do this with a set of graphs. Remember early on, I told you we loved graphs, so we have some in this chapter too. This intro slide describes what we're going to talk about with our graphs, but what I want to do is go to a blank screen and basically replicate that first graph that we had that was just shown. So in this graph, our x-axis is showing reaction progress. If I start completely with reactants and end completely with products, we don't care about the timing here, we're just looking at reaction progress. And our y-axis is a value of g. Now, one th important thing to recognize is the value of g is not measurable. So it's not like we can go into lab, collect data, and duplicate this graph. This graph is more useful after we know some information about a reaction and help us interpret what's going on with that reaction. So again, to try to somewhat duplicate the graph that was on the previous slide, our reactants had a G value that was higher. Our products had a G value that was lower. And the first thing to recognize on a graph like this is we can actually take the difference between these two values to calculate the change in delta G naught. So remember, anytime we want to calculate change, we are setting it up as products minus reactants. Hopefully, you recognize that because my products are lower and my reactants are higher, this means that I'm going to get an overall negative value for delta G naught for this reaction. And what we start to define is that when delta G naught is negative, this tells me that I have a product-favored reaction at equilibrium. So remember, reactant or product favored is specifically once the system has come to equilibrium, we can determine that. Well, and we've been studying it all semester. Since we know what happens at equilibrium, we can also predict a relative value of our equilibrium constant. Remember, our K values, our expressions, are written as products over reactants. So if my system is product favored, it means I have a larger quantity in my numerator. And this means that I will get an equilibrium constant that is greater than one. Also, realize that equilibrium constants have to be relative to the value of one. They can only be large or small. K values can't be negative, so I could never write relative to zero here. So we got all of that information just from our beginning and ending points on our graph. So drawing our graph, we also see that we have a shape that looks a little something like this. And the key thing to recognize here is, I'm going to see if I can add. Ah, yes, we do have more colors. There it is. I'm going to add two other colors in here. Let's go with purple. Let's get creative. The other thing that we can determine from a graph like this is where our reaction is with reference to equilibrium. So, for example, let's say I mark this spot on the graph. I want to know if my reaction is still moving forward to reach equilibrium or if it's moving backwards. Well, for a graph like this, think of it as some weird artistic bowl, right? I have this weird shaped bowl that starts up high on one side and lower on the other. If I were to take a marble and drop it in this bowl, where is that marble going to come to a stop? Hopefully, you said down here at the bottom. And that's exactly true. So in this graph, the very, very bottom part of our graph marks the point where our system reaches equilibrium. Notice on our x-axis that this position of equilibrium is more toward the products, which exactly matches our prediction or determination over here. All right, so coming back to this x that I've marked on our graph over here, at any point on this graph, I can actually determine the sine of delta G. And I do that by looking at the slope of the tangent of this dotted line that I've made. If I look at the slope of this tangent, I see that I would have a negative sine. Remember that we've defined delta G as spontaneity. Whenever it's negative, this tells us that at that point on our graph, we have a spontaneous reaction. Again, spontaneous means that our reaction is still moving forward to reach equilibrium. So let's take a look at a point on the right side of our graph. We can do the same thing over here. Again, I'm going to draw ideally a tangent to that point. And if I look at the slope of that tangent, I get a positive value. Remember that a positive value of delta G means we have a non-spontaneous reaction, which should make sense. If my ball in this weird bowl is at this X value, it's not going to keep moving forward. My reaction is going to, in fact, move in the reverse direction to reach equilibrium. So again, we already pointed out where equilibrium is. We already know that equilibrium is at this minimum point. And if we look at the slope of our tangent at this point, we see that delta G is equal to zero. So a couple of videos ago, we defined that when delta G non-standard equals zero, this is when our system has reached equilibrium. For every graph, that's going to be the very minimum of our graph. All right, let's go through all of those same steps for now a reactant favored graph. A little bit more quickly here, again, starting with the same thing, our x-axis is reaction progress, reactants to products. For this one, if I'm looking for a reactant-favored system, drawing on what we deduced on the last screen, it means that I should have a positive value of delta G naught. And so again, that means when I calculate products minus reactants, I should get a positive value. So my products should be higher than my reactants. Sorry, I forgot to label my y-axis as G. And so for a reactant-favored system, it's going to look like this. Because I know it's reactant-favored, I also know my equilibrium must lie closer to the reactant. So that's my minimum. So connecting my dots now, or my points here, as smoothly as possible. Pretend that's smooth, not a check mark. And now we can again go through the same steps. Any point left of that minimum is going to have a negative slope or be spontaneous. At that point, my reaction is still moving forward. Any point to the right of that, I'm going to have a slope that is a positive value, meaning the value of delta G is greater than zero. At that point, my reaction is non-spontaneous. It's not going to keep going forward. In fact, to reach equilibrium, it has to go in the reverse direction. And so, like all of our graphs, equilibrium is going to be at the very minimum. This is where delta G equals zero. This is equilibrium. And again, we can see that it is more toward the reactant side. So a quick summary of the key features we can determine from these types of graphs. We can calculate or determine the sine of delta G naught, looking at products minus reactants, literally on the y-axis. And then we can determine the relative value of K from those, which I just realized I forgot to do on this previous slide. For any reactant favored system, of course, reactants are favored. They're in the denominator, so we get a K value that's less than one. The second key feature is that we can determine where equilibrium will lie. That will always be the minimum on the graph, where our non-standard delta G equals zero. And then spontaneity at any given point. Again, spontaneity is using non-standard delta G values. So we look at the slope of the tangent at any given point. Negative tells us it's spontaneous. Positive means it's non-spontaneous. And that will always be left or right of equilibrium. And so in the notes, I have this follow-up slide for a reactant-favored system. The follow-up question that I always like to give students is to determine what the graph would look like for a reaction where K equals 1, and what would your value of delta G naught be? I will ask you to pause the video here and try to sketch a graph that meets these two criteria and see what you come up with. When you come back to the video, I will draw it out for you. Okay, I'm assuming that you paused and that you took a shot at this. So again, we start with reaction progress on the x-axis. Our y-axis is G. Realize that if I'm looking for a reaction where K equals 1, that means at equilibrium I have roughly equal amounts of reactants and products in my system, right? In order to get that ratio of K to be 1, they would have to be the same. So if that's the case, that means my equilibrium has to be at about the halfway point. Right, that's going to give me equal amounts of reactants and products. When I drop this down, here's my equilibrium. And the only way for that to happen is to have roughly the same value on the y-axis for my reactants and products. And so when we sketch this out, we get something that roughly looks like that. When I draw this on the board, I always draw it into a happy face. Yay! All right. And so if we have the same values for reactants and products on our y-axis, what is our value of delta G naught? Hopefully you can see that since they're equal, that is actually going to be a value of zero. Just for the record, I don't know of any reactions off the top of my head that actually meet this criteria. They're reactions that are close to K equals one, but I don't know of any where it is exactly equals one.